Hello all. I am Vignesh. I am working with Fujitsu India. I'm basically from India. So I've been working, I have been using Postgres from last 10 years, but have been more active in Postgres from the last 3 years. My area of interest is on logical replication and parallelism. Today I'll be presenting a talk on logical replication. So my agenda for today's talk will be what are the different replication types, and then a brief introduction about them, and what are the different use cases for logical replication. There are few restrictions that are present with logical replication that we need to take care. I'll mention those. And then what's the architecture, a little bit of internals, how it works. And so there are what are, we use the terms publication and subscriptions quite often. So I'll be explaining what do you mean by publication, what do you mean by subscriptions. And we need to handle some configurations before we do the logical replication setup. So what are the configurations, that main configurations, how to set those values, and what are the steps that's involved in creating a logical replication setup. Then we have few catalog tables. So if there is an issue, how to diagnose. So we have some catalog tables and monitoring we can do. So how to do that. And there are a lot of active work that's going on. So I'll just explain one by one about the features and few restrictions that are present we would like to remove. So I'll just introduce those. So in replication, we have mainly physical replication and logical replication. So in case of physical replication, it's mainly to replicate the complete data from the primary node to the standby node. So all the data will be read from wall and will be shipped to the standby node. So the data will be always intact, and we will have access to the complete data in the standby. So this is mainly useful for the failover situation. So if anything happens to the primary, we can quickly switch to the standby node. And the standby will, we can make the standby node as the primary node. So there are few restrictions in physical replication. So we'll have to replicate the complete database. There is no option where we can replicate a part of the database or just a table. So those kind of option is not available. And we cannot replicate between two different minor major versions. And so the users cannot do any write operations in the standby server. It will always be in read-only mode. And we cannot replicate between different platforms. So we cannot have the primary in one platform and the subscriber in another platform. So to overcome all these limitations, logical replication was developed. So logical replication is a method in which we replicate data from the publisher to subscriber. So unlike physical replication, where we call mainly primary and standby, in logical replication we will be seeing the terms publisher and subscriber. So publisher will be publishing the data to the subscriber node. So here there is a lot of flexibility. So based on the configuration that we have configured, whether to publish all the tables or only few tables, or only certain operations like insert from the publisher table, all that is possible, and you can we can send us cascade this replication. So maybe send the data from one publication to the subscriber, and the subscriber can have another publication which will publish data to another node. So that kind of flexibility is present in logical replication. So DB has more options. So what are the main use cases that we should use when we should use logical replication? So it's like if you want to just publish one table or a few tables data, or if you want to just publish just insert operations from a table, or if you want to publish just update delete operations. So those are that at that time we can use the logical replication, and this is also a good feature. So like when we want to consolidate multiple databases from different data nodes into a single node, right? So that is possible when we can consolidate multiple database data into a single node. So this single node can be used for analytical purposes. So we'll have the huge chunk of data. So all the OLTP data can be consolidated, and then later we can do analysis. So replicating between major versions is also possible. So we can have the publisher in one version and subscriber in another version. So we can have the publisher running on different platform and the subscriber on a totally different platform. That's also possible. So this can also be used for security purpose if we just want to provide partial data to some users. So just replicate the data that user needs and the user can access it. So all these use cases it will help us in using logical replication. There are few restrictions that are present that we should take care. So the tables should be fully qualified in both the publisher and the subscriber. So we need to make sure that the tables are configured in such a way. So and the second thing is that bidirectional replication is not supported. So data will be sent from publisher to the subscriber. So any changes in the subscriber will not be sent to the publisher. So another thing is we will not replicate the create statements. So the create statements currently is not supported. We will have to use maybe pgdump and make the table setup in the subscription. Replication of sequences is not supported. Replication of large objects is not supported currently. And so the subscriber table and the publication table can be slightly different, such that the subscriber can have more columns. But one small restriction is that the column names should match and the column type should match with the publisher. And when we create the all publication of publication for all tables, user need to have super user privileges. And currently publishing to the same host is not supported. So hopefully these things will get handled in the coming versions. So now let's have a look at the architecture. I'll just see, let you know how things work in the internals. So basically we will have we'll have the publisher and we'll have the subscriber. So we will configure the publication in the publisher node, saying this publisher is responsible for sending all tables or some tables data. So we need to configure it in the publication. And then in the subscriber, we need to create a subscription saying we will be subscribing to this host. So we need to give the connection details and which publication we are interested in. So once we specify this, the subscriber will connect to the publisher. So once he connects, the subscriber will ask for the publication to fetch all the tables that this publication is part of. So once subscriber gets this table list, subscriber will then start synchronizing these tables data. So we will internally use copy command to get the data from publisher. So start a transaction or snapshot will be created at the beginning and copy all the data from publisher to the subscriber. So this is the table synchronization phase. So once table synchronization phase is done, then we will start reading the wall files. So the publisher will check record by record. So for each record, it will see if it will decode the data and check if this data is applicable for this particular publication. If it is applicable, it will start queuing this transaction data into the reorder buffer queue. So, and it will continue this, it will keep continuing this decode operation till the transaction is committed. So we will have a queue of transaction data present in the publication. So for small transaction, the memory will be sufficient. So if it's a big transaction, so we have been configured the reorder buffer is configured based on the logical decoding work mem. So that much memory it will be allocated. So once the transaction data exceeds this logical decoding work memory, it will be spilled to disk. So currently this memory is 64 MB. So we should make sure that we have configured based on the correct based on our transactions that we expect. So it shouldn't be that we choose a too low value. So that will result in frequent write to disk and the performance will be bad. So some kind of ideal value need to be chosen for this. And there is also an option wherein if you don't want the complete data to be lying in the publisher, we can have our streaming option enabled in the subscriber. So when streaming option is enabled, these data will be sent to the subscriber. So until commit the all these operations, right, based on the configuration will be lying in the publication side. So the publisher will maintain this memory. So only once the transaction is committed, this complete data, the reorder buffer transaction data will be sent to the subscriber. And the subscriber will start applying this changes in the subscriber. So if the transaction gets aborted, on the publisher side itself, we will destroy the transaction data and this data will not be sent to the subscriber. So I just explain the things, what are the different things that's happening in the internals. So if you see, all these things will be, we have five modules that takes care of this work. So in the publisher side, we have wall sender, table sync, and replication slot. And in the subscriber side, we have the logical replication launcher and logical replication worker, which handles all this work. So this, in the publisher side, wall sender will take care of sending the wall records from primary server to the subscriber. This process will be started when subscriber will connect to the publisher and asks and subscribe to the data. Table sync process is responsible for synchronizing the table data from the publisher to subscriber. So based on the number of tables and based on the configuration, it will, this process can happen parallelly. So if we have a number of tables, so based on the configuration, that many tables data can be synchronized parallelly to the subscriber. So replication slot will maintain the wall information. So it will maintain which, up to which wall the wall archiver can delete. So which is at least from which, in which wall record the information need to be maintained in the system, and wall and replication slot will maintain, will move the wall location as and when the transaction is committed in the subscriber. And logical replication launcher is present in the subscriber. So this process is responsible for starting the logical replication workers in the subscriber side. So logical replication worker, so this process is responsible for applying the logical changes as and when they come from the publisher. It will be started by the logical replication launcher for the subscriptions. So we use wall sender protocol to communicate data with publisher. So it is based on libpq code that we connect. So apply worker will use libpq APIs to connect with the wall sender and get the data. So we have been talking about publication. So publication is a logical entity in the system. So it is present in the master server. So we can specify what are the changes this publication will be sending to the subscriber. So it can be for a table or a group of tables or some operations in a particular table. So it will be at one database. So we need to have, if you want multiple databases data, we need to have multiple publications. So, and a single publication can publish multiple tables data, and the same table can be present in multiple publications. So subscriber subscription is the downstream side of the logical replication. This node is responsible for getting the data. So we call this node as the subscriber. Subscription defines the connection to the database and the what are the publications data that it need to subscribe. So we have different types of publications. So I'll just explain what are the different types. So if we want to publish some optional, some selective tables, you need to specify create publication, the publication name for table and what are the tables. So this can be one table or it can be multiple tables. So that can be specified here. So then we can publish all the tables data. So to publish all the tables data, create the publication name for all tables. So that's the difference here. And we can publish certain operations like insert, update, or delete. So if you want to publish insert operation, create a publication, the publication name for table name with so here I'm publishing insert operation, so we need to specify insert. So similarly, we can specify update or delete also, delete operation also. So one thing that we need to note is that if we publish update or delete operations, we need to make sure that the replica identity is created for the tables. So you would have seen in the alter table, has replica identity. So we need to specify that option. That option is only used for the for this logical replication purpose. So that logical the replica identity will help us to identify the rows uniquely in the system. So that need to be configured. So once you have created the publication, if you want to change, it is possible. So here, if you want to change it, change the publication to publish, update, and delete operation. So alter publication, the publication name, set publish equal to update and delete. Okay. And if you want to add more tables, so like we have configured the publication for few tables, and now we feel we should add more tables. So alter the publication name, add table. So what are the tables? This can be one or more number of tables here. So once all the operation is finished, if you feel we don't need the logical replication anymore, just drop the publication. It's simple, similar to other operations, drop publication name. And the subscriber side, if you want to create subscription to multiple publications, so create subscription, subscriber name, up till here it's similar. And then we need to specify the connection. So which host, what is the port, and which user, and the database name that we will subscribe. So, and which publication. So this can be one or more publications in the publisher note. And if we want to create the subscription in disable state, so here subscriber won't be running. So just say create subscription, the subscription name, connection, and which publisher with enable default. So this we use mainly for the network maintenance. It can be enabled later, so once all the network maintenance work is finished. So synchronous commit. So this feature is useful by default. So any transaction that we commit in the publication will publish the data asynchronously to subscriber. So publisher node, we will not wait until the transaction is committed. So it will commit, and maybe after some time it will be committed to the subscriber. So there are a lot of overhead involved. So publisher will publish the data, and once it is applied, it will commit in the subscriber. But if you don't want that you want to make sure that the publisher data should be committed only when the subscriber data is committed. So we have an option for that, synchronous commit. So syntax is like create the subscription, specify the connection, the publication, and with we need to specify the synchronous commit is true. And so there is an option where we can say whether to copy the data or not when the subscription is created. So similar syntax is similar to others, create the subscription, provide the connection details, and then in with copy data, true or false. So the streaming option is for sending the in-progress transactions. So by default, this option is false, and we will not send this data until we receive commit. So until commit, all the data will be present in the publisher node. So, and once we receive commit, publisher will have to send the complete data. So that might cause a slightly delay of the transaction to be committed in the subscriber. So if you don't want this, we can use this option, and it will keep sending the in-progress transactions. So after we create the subscription, similar to the publication, we can change the subscription. So if we want to change the publication, so initially if we have configured to a different publication and now we need to change it, so just say alter subscription name, set the publication name to different one. And if you want to disable a subscription, so if you want to do some maintenance activity, just say alter subscription name disable. So and we can refresh the publications. So any changes that is happening in the publication site, if so the tables have changed, so table list is changed for the publication, we can do a alter subscription refresh publication. So this, once we do this, it will get the tables from the publisher again. So if any change is done in the publisher, that will be synced up at this time. So once all work is done, just drop the subscription name. So there are a bunch of configuration parameters that we need to keep in mind. So this is one of the important parameters, logical decoding work memory. So this specifies the maximum memory that should be used for logical decoding. So if our changes are more than this, it will either spill to disk or it will send to the subscriber. And so the maximum wall senders, so maximum number of wall senders that should be running simultaneously. And then wall sender timeout. So the replication connections will become inactive after this amount of time. And then maximum replication slot will specify the number of replication slots that server can support. So each of the publications will use replication slots. So if we have more number of publications in the system, this value need to be increased. And maximum logical replication workers, it specifies the number of logical replication workers. So it includes both the apply worker and the table sync workers. So this will be taken from max worker process. So if the system runs parallelism heavily, so these values need to be adjusted. And then we have wall receiver timeout. So this will terminate the replication connections if it is inactive for this amount of time. So this is like max sync workers per subscription. So maximum number of table sync that can happen per subscription. So if you have a lot of tables and we need to do a lot of table sync and we have lot of huge amount of data, so this can be configured to a higher value. So this will be used only at the initial phase. So based on this value will be taken from max logical replication workers. So these are the steps that we need to take care in the publisher side. So a bunch of configuration that we need to take care. So we need to make sure that the wall level is set to logical. So for logical decoding, we add some extra information in the wall, so that which will be needed during logical decoding. So and then set the maximum wall senders. This will be based on the number of publications we have in the system with different subscriptions. So and then we have the wall sender timeout. So this is based on the network. We can set it accordingly. And the logical decoding workmem. So this will be used for storing the decoded transaction data in memory until commit. And then set up the PG/HBA conf for the replication user. And then create the publication. So based on whether it is for all table or for certain tables, so create the publication. And we need to grant select permissions for these tables. So internally, we will be using copy command to send the data from the subscriber. So we need to grant select permission to the replication user. And so the table creation need to be done manually in the subscriber. Currently, this is a limitation with logical replication. So pgdump is quite useful for us. So once we identify what are the tables that need to be published, so use this command, the pgdump, the which database, and the only schema alone. And here we need to specify the list of tables and pipe it to psql command. So this here we need to provide the subscriber connection string. So once we execute this command, all the tables will be created in the subscriber. And in the subscriber site, set up the configuration. Wall receiver timeout we need to specify and create the subscription. So we need to provide the publication connection string here and what are the publication that we need to be specified. So once we are done with this, we will be getting all the table data and any changes happening on the publisher, those table data will be present in the subscriber. So there is a bunch of tables, catalog tables that will be quite useful. So we have PG publication. So here we can see what all publications are present in the system. And this is also quite a useful catalog table, PG publication relation. So here we will maintain the publication and the tables information. So we can see the user has created the publication for which all tables. So this mapping is like between publication and relation. And similarly, we have the catalog table in the subscription, PG subscription, which will list all the logical replication subscriptions. And similarly, we have PG subscription relation. So this catalog contains the subscription relation, subscription and the relation and is present in the subscription. We can see which all relations are present. And PG replication slot. So this will give us all the replication slots that are currently created and which are being used for logical replication. And if we were for monitoring purpose, we have PG stat replication slots. So this view contains the logical replication slot statistic usage information. And PG stat replication, this contains the wall center stat information in. So what is sent to the subscriber. We have a lot of active work that's happening in logical replication. So two-phase transaction, logical replication of tables in a schema, skip tables, row filtering, column filtering, and skipping some particular transaction in subscriber side. So I'll just briefly explain about the work that's happening. So up till now, we were able to send only the transaction data at commit time. So new feature is being developed. This is going to be committed pretty soon. So wherein the two-phase transaction data. So when the prepare happens, so even at prepare, the transaction decoded up to prepare will be sent to the subscriber. So with this option, we will be able to decode commands like prepare transaction, commit prepared, and rollback the prepared. So earlier we were decoding and sending the transaction information at commit. So here it will help us in sending at prepare transaction time. So only a small change is done in the syntax. The with option is enabled, wherein we can specify two-phase equal to true. So then if you specify this, it will take care of it. So up till now, we were not supporting logical replication of tables in a schema. So either user need to publish one schema tables data, user will have to manually identify what are the tables that are present in the schema and create a publication. So this new option is being added to the publication, wherein we can specify which schema data need to be published. So here is this. It's the create publication statement is extended to include the for schema. So and you can specify it can be a single schema or a multiple schema. And after creation, if you want to add the schema, just say add schema name. And there is also an option to skip tables. So up till now, if he wanted all the tables but just skip one table, so he couldn't use all tables. So user will have to identify all the tables present, get the list, and create a publication for that particular publication. And he need to remove that tables and specify it in create publication. So new option is being added. So wherein we can specify along with all tables, which table need to be skipped. So this again is like we can specify one table or multiple tables. And similarly, there is an alter publication. So wherein we can add skip tables later once we have created the publication. And this row filtering feature, so up till now we had to send the complete tables data. So this feature adds row filtering capacity. So you can specify where clause along with the publication table. So you can specify the which rows you want. So like, you know, so here you only when A is greater than 100, only those rows will be sent to the subscriber. So this option is added recently, is being added recently. And column filtering. So up till now, we'll have to send all the column data. But if user intends, like he wanted only a few column data from publisher to the subscriber, so a new option is added. So this reduces the network consumption. So wherein we were sending complete data earlier, so all those data will be filtered in the publisher side and it won't be sent. So here along with table name, we can specify the column name optionally. This new option is added. And similarly, if you want to change the columns that need to be added, so that can be done using alter publication at a later point of time. So this is quite a good feature, like that's being developed. So skipping logical replication transactions. When we publish data from the publication to the subscriber, there is a possibility that there can be an the subscriber side, maybe the table is not present or the constraint is violated. So when this kind of situation happens, the subscriber will not receive any more any new data. So it will wait until user intervenes and resolves this problem. So ideally what we will do is we will maybe create the table if the table is needed, and in case of conflict, maybe we will check and delete the row. So this to solve the problem. So or else we will have to advance the LSN in LSN and in the publisher and subscriber. So but when we advance the LSN, we will not be able to skip exactly one transaction. We'll be ending up skipping more transactions. So there is a new feature being added wherein we can skip one particular transaction in the subscription. So identify which transaction is causing this error in the subscription and specify it. So this transaction will be skipped in the subscriber, and it will then the subscriber will start receiving the new set of transaction data. And once that all the transaction data is fine, there is no conflict, so reset the skip transaction. So there are few limitations that I have told, so that maybe will be picked up in the future and handled. So there is a lot of interest for this. So wherein we don't currently send the DDL statements. So if we use pgdump to create the tables in the subscriber, so if this can be handled, then that step will be removed. And we have some restrictions wherein we'll have to use super user for creating all tables publication. So this might be removed in the future, and currently sequences is not supported, logical replication of sequences is not supported, so that will be handled, and large object replication is also not supported, and the bidirectional replication is currently not supported. So we just send data from publisher to subscriber. So maybe if we can address this together, it'll be good. So logical replication will become a complete solution. Yeah, thank you. So these are the things that I had to present today.
So thank you, and it was like very concentrated technical talk. I'm afraid we have time only for a couple of questions, but anyway, there are lots of questions in the chat, so we try our best to answer them. So the first question is, can I use the logical replication if need to get just a subset of original table, limited number of fields on subscriber side? What happens if I did some fields, if I add some fields to the table on the publisher side?
I didn't get the question clearly, but I'll try to answer. Is the question like maybe...
can you replicate a subset of a table?
There can be two possible. Yeah, so currently there is one option. So wherein we can publish only certain operation, like maybe insert, update, or delete. That is possible. But there is no option like wherein we can filter some data, like if we want to use a where condition. So there is a feature that is currently happening, and a lot of discussion is happening. So I'd explained it in the current work. So a lot of discussion is happening on this. Maybe once we get this feature, so we will be able to replicate a subset of data. So we can specify the condition and that data will be sent. So the patch is available, but more fine tuning is required in the community. So we should be able to get, we might get it in this version.
Thank you. Another question is, a person who asked and didn't get an idea of what alter publication at skip table does. Can you explain that once more?
Okay. So initially, if we have created the publication for, we will generally create publication for all tables or maybe certain set of tables. And later, we feel that we need to skip one particular table. So we will publish, we are publishing, let's say, 100 tables data. And later we come to know that we don't want to publish 100 table data. Only 99 is required. We need to skip one table data. So in this case, we can just do an alter publication, add skip table. So maybe some confidential employee details table. And so it will stop skipping. It will start skipping this table's data. The rest 99 tables data will be sent.
Thank you. I think that would be the last question. Or maybe we have time for two. Skip and fail transactions is not safe, as every failed transaction has a reason. Will skip a transaction be logged somewhere to investigate what's happened?
Actually, so by default, the transaction will not be skipped. So what will happen is when there is an error in the subscriber, the error will be logged, and the subscriber side, we will not advance. So whatever data we have received from publisher, the subscriber will keep failing and it will exiting, and it will tell in the subscriber that this error has occurred. So generally what will happen is DBA will intervene. He will identify what is the error that is present. So by default, he will either create the table if the table is missing, or if there is a conflicting record, right? He will analyze and take care what need to be done. But if the user feels that this particular transaction need to be skipped, right? So only in this case, this need to be specified explicitly to solve this scenario. So we don't want to adjust the wall instead of wall adjustment. So system itself will take care if we specify the transaction that need to be used. So that is not a default operation. So only on need basis it will be used.
Yeah, thank you. So we regret to say we run out of time. Thank you for very technical detailed talk, and thank you for coming. Now we proceed to the Q&A session with Vignesh. I think there are a couple of questions still not answered. We can copy them there, and Vignesh will answer them. Thank you. And yeah. We need to say hello to our next speaker. We'll be back soon after we set up the next talk. See you.